Wait. You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Big day today, everybody. Big day. It's Wednesday. It's Big Wednesday. Let's call it Big Wednesday. Let's call it Big Hump Day. Let's go back to Big Wednesday. It's a Big Wednesday, and it's TV Guidance Counselor, as always. It's Wednesday, and I'm Ken Reed, as always, the host of TV Guidance Counselor. But why is this show so big today? One very big reason. My guest is Mr. Brice Beckham, and you most likely know Brice from his portrayal of the character of Wesley Owens on Mr. Belvedere, a show that I love that comes up very often on this show, but he is an incredible writer and performer and comedian in his own right now, as he was on the show then, and he is one of the first people that I thought of that I wanted to have as a guest on this show when I started it 3+ years ago, which I say to him in this episode. And I cannot believe I finally got to sit down and talk to him. As I said, I've loved his work. He was gracious enough to put up with my annoyance and sit down and talk to me. And it went very well. Fascinating guy, really funny guy, super down to earth. And I love talking to him, and I think you will love hearing me talk to him. In fact, I know you will. Here is the episode. This is Brice Beckham, a long time in the works. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy my conversation with Brice Beckham.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Mr. Brice Beckham, how are you?
I'm great.
Thank you so much for doing this.
Yeah, I'm excited to talk sure, to
you.
Sure thing.
You're one of the first people that I thought of as someone I wanted to have on the show when I started the show. So I'm very excited
Excellent.
To have you on.
And I feel like you've been bugging me about it for a while.
I have. It's been a long time. Like, even before I thought of the show, I was like, hey, I'm going to have a show, and I'm going to bug you about it when I think of what it is. And you were like, please don't contact me at home.
No, I had other things to do.
Yeah, you were busy.
It wasn't you.
You were busy. It's not you, it's me. And we went like late 80s, early 90s, and immediately, and I will take full responsibility for this, I handed you an issue with the Challenger explosion on the cover. It's not the explosion. Yeah. It's
the TV movie about the Challenger.
Yeah. Which at the time I remember seemed like was a really long time after the Challenger, but now looking at the actual dates was only 4 years after it happened.
Yeah.
And that seems like a really short time to make that
Too
TV
soon.
Movie.
Yeah. Too soon.
Yeah. Although now we have movies like where, like that movie that it's not a TV movie because they don't do those anymore. But when they made that movie about like the Obamas, like the young Obamas falling in love while they're like still, that seemed really weird.
Yeah, it did. I mean, I actually thought it was a little weird that they made the young Obama movie on Netflix that has already come out.
Yeah, it's very strange, like the timelines for those. I miss the made-for-TV movie, I will say. That's maybe the biggest loss from like the classic age of television that I missed, because they were a big deal. They aren't on video. They don't really stream anywhere.
Yeah.
And they're just lost. Like hundreds and hundreds of these movies with big-name people in them are completely lost.
Well, and a lot of them were pilots for that would become shows. You know, they would test them out with these two-hour, like Knight Rider and shows like that.
Were you ever asked to do any of those? They would always do every summer, like, here's all the teen actors in a made-for-TV movie, like Dance Till Dawn and Crash Course.
No, I never was. I know Rob did at least one.
Yeah, he was in Dance Till Dawn, I think.
Rob Stone played my older brother. And I'm trying to think. I definitely didn't. Not one of those kind, anyway.
Because they always felt like they had they were like indentured, like they had to do them. Yeah. Like, look, we're not shooting this summer, but we own you, so you're in this thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We did once or twice we would host a wraparound for Saturday morning cartoons.
Yes.
Where we would introduce all the new shows. That was kind of fun.
You were probably sadly too old to be as excited about that as you could have been if it was 5 years earlier and you've been hosting that.
Yeah, exactly.
Because those were the biggest deal ever.
Yeah, I did watch some of them, even at that point. But by that age, it was kind of just all right, you're gonna save this copy for
Then you can
10
leave.
Seconds and yeah. So
Foofer really isn't exciting here at the point of the day.
But yeah, I remember introducing like the gummy bears and
yep.
a couple things like that.
Which has a completely infectious theme song that
yeah.
still will sometimes haunt me.
Yeah, and actually I remember the animation for that show being really good. That
yeah.
was like Disney was stepping up their game on the weekly animation show.
Well, the interesting thing about that was Disney as a movie studio was almost bankrupt.
Yeah.
And they had just made, I think, The Black Cauldron was the last thing they did.
Yeah.
It was a huge bomb.
It was right before the Renaissance.
Yeah, they were like, well, we might as well try TV because we're going to go out of business. Mm-hmm. So they did that, and they did the Wuzzles,
uh-huh.
which is two
yeah.
times the fun,
right.
Wrapped up and rolled into one. And then that was did so well that they did the DuckTales in the afternoon stuff.
Yeah.
But it saved that whole studio, and then they yeah. started making movies again. And Gummy Bears was like the show that did it. And it
yeah.
was, people were like, wow, this is animated like a real thing. It's not
yeah.
like cheap Saturday morning
yeah,
stuff.
Yeah, it looks like, you know, what now you would see as the direct-to-DVD like
right.
sequel.
The sequel. The Return of Jafar.
Yeah, exactly.
there, yeah. Which was kind of the body chemistry, too, of the Aladdin series.
I actually knew the cover artist for the Return of Jafar home video
yeah, yeah,
box.
Yeah.
Was the husband of one of my kindergarten teachers.
Oh, really?
Weirdly.
She
yeah.
come in and brag and be like, guys, my husband made the Return of Jafar thing.
Yeah.
But you did some cartoon voiceover at times.
I did a little bit. I did an episode of Pound Puppies, and I did an episode of Prince Valiant.
Oh, yeah.
Which
yeah.
I never even saw. I worked on that. I worked with Tim Curry. Kind of. I mean, I didn't really work with Tim Curry, but we were in the room.
Yeah. He did a ton, like in the late 80s, he was doing like Pirates of Dark Water, and he did the Hook cartoon,
mm-hmm.
the Peter Pan one.
And, yeah, this was right at that same time.
Yeah, because one of the first things you did as a kid was like radio ads and stuff, right? You were kind of doing voiceover things.
That's true. You know a lot about me.
I know. I'm sorry.
no, my dad worked in radio and in advertising, and so he would write radio ads and did a lot of voiceover himself. He studied under Dawes Butler
oh, wow.
at Hanna-Barbera.
Yeah.
So his big claim to fame as a voiceover artist was the campaign for the Coors Party Ball.
Oh, nice.
He was the announcer for that. So yeah, it was a pretty easy in for me to start doing radio commercial, like local spots for
right.
him.
We need a kid to be like, come on down.
Yeah.
Whatever. Yeah.
I think I did one for a paint company. The name's escaping me at the moment. Couple different things like that. And then now he's a pastor.
Oh, really?
Because that's what you want to go from, you know, you
yeah.
want to go from advertising, which is like the devil's work, straight into
well,
clergyman.
Well, you learn all the evil skills.
Yes.
And then you flip
exactly.
them. It's
yeah.
Like, yeah. Dawes
yeah.
Butler told him to do that.
Salesmanship.
He was like, look, after 20 years, become a pastor. It's what
yeah.
I wish I had done. And you need to go do it. But were you sort of more aware of, when you would watch a cartoon as a kid because of that, like there were people doing the voices and that kind of stuff because your dad did it for work?
I don't know if I'd say I was more aware. I mean, no more aware than I think you're aware that there are actors playing characters on
right.
TV shows and stuff. I do, but, you know, I would know some of their names that I wouldn't
right.
know otherwise. Like the guy who played the Venkman role in the real Ghostbusters was
right.
also Garfield.
Yep, Lorenzo Music.
Lorenzo Music,
and
that's
he,
right.
he did the music for the Bob Newhart show. He wrote the theme song
yeah.
for the Bob Newhart show and was wrote his doorman.
Yeah.
This is my doorman. Which is so funny that he did Garfield's voice and then Bill Murray did Garfield's voice in the movie and
right.
he did Venkman's voice in the cartoon.
In the cartoon, yeah.
yeah. It's like a weird trading
yeah.
of the night.
They, you know, they do sound kind of similar.
And Dave Coulier did it later. He did,
oh, did
a
he?
Bunch of voices. Yeah, they. It was really.
I mean,
weird
I knew he did Muppet Babies.
He
and
did
that
Muppet
stuff.
Babies along with Howie Mandel.
Right.
And then Dave Coulier did a lot of the real Ghostbusters voices. Poor Ernie Hudson auditioned for his character's voice and
oh.
didn't get it, and Arsenio Hall got it.
Oh wow!
Which is really rough. But Dave Coulier, one of the things he used to do was, and we were talking about this off mic earlier, when they would need to redub a movie for TV
uh-huh.
and replace the swear, he would come in and do an impression of that person and do the voice.
Okay.
And one of the guys he specialized in was Richard Pryor.
Really?
Yeah. So
they had Dave Coulier do Richard
yes,
Pryor?
Yeah, because apparently he used to do like a Richard Pryor impersonation in his act. So he was the guy, the go-to guy to do Richard Pryor's swear replacements and all the made when Richard Pryor was
wow.
on TV. Which I don't know if that's like a well-kept secret or not. But
that's fascinating.
Which is crazy.
Every once in a while, you know, you see these clips of what certain movies sound like in other languages.
Yeah.
And so many of those actors are so dead on. It's really impressive.
And they make a career out of it, too. Like, they're like, I always do this guy.
Yeah.
When I worked in radio in the late 90s or 2000s, it was kind of like right when DVDs sort of came out. And I was like, they were always trying to get us to do new games for people to call in. So I was like, well, we'll use one of the alternate language tracks from a DVD, and then they'll have to guess what movie it is.
Mm-hmm.
And they were like, no. But I was like, oh, come on, that's a great game. It would be like whatever the most famous line is, and it's in Portuguese.
Right.
And it's audio and whatever. And they were like, no, instead we're going to do a game where we had Joey McIntyre, Kids on the Block, come in, and they tried to get him to do this game that they thought was better called Get a Hummer from Joey Mack. And he would hum a song. And
then God.
And that's when I found out one of the new kids was gay. Joey Mack goes, you got the wrong new kid for that. And he's like, I'll tell you. And we're like, oh, boy. But that was where I really started listening to the alternative language tracks in a lot of movies for pushing that. But sadly, was not to be. So you went from that to Belvedere, and that was kind of there wasn't a lot of other roles in between there, right?
I started auditioning professionally, not just being cast by my dad.
Nepotism at its finest.
Right. I started auditioning professionally at, I don't, was I 7 or 8? And then only about 6 months after I started auditioning, I did a role on Alice.
Oh, yeah.
I was in an episode with Rue McClanahan, and also Benji, who was the kid on Alf, was in that episode with me. The AD on that episode was in my network read for Belvedere only, you know, a few months later.
Right.
And he remembered me and thought I was great. Good old Don Corvin. You know, I had a little inside help there on Belvedere. But yeah, Belvedere was my second on-camera job.
You're like, this is easy. You just go and you get serious. Yeah, that's
just walk into these rooms, say some lines, and they give you a job.
Dad gives you some work. You go in and get a job.
Yeah, I did a bit of auditioning. I didn't get everything I tried out for, but I did have a very good like first year and a half, 2 years.
Did you watch Alice before you were on it?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
So how weird was that to like be on the set and like Vic Tayback's there and in the diner, you know, that you had watched on TV.
It was pretty crazy. I remember thinking that the set felt a lot smaller in person than it looks on camera.
Yeah.
Partially because, you know, where they cut off, where the roof would be, there's a bunch of lights there.
Right.
And, you know, you think they're in these studios, which have these huge high roofs, but then the lights are right there. I do remember that. I remember it being a lot smaller. And then seeing how they did, like, satellite sets, because the one I was in involved a daycare center, and so they had, you know, a temporary set for that, which was right next to the diner.
Right.
Like, they were,
what a weird business. Yeah, it's a diner, like, slash daycare center.
They shared a corner. And seeing how all that worked in person was pretty interesting.
Did you watch the, do you remember watching the episode when it aired? Was it like, did the whole family get together and we're like, this is
absolutely
a big deal?
Absolutely. Really? And you know, back then, we recorded everything I was in on VHS.
Right.
Because that was how you had to do it. There was no, you know, ordering the DVD later on.
We'll just stream it on YouTube later.
Yeah.
Yeah. Were there, did you have family that weren't in the industry or that lived somewhere else in the country?
Most of my family was not in the industry. I was kind of tutored in basic acting techniques by my aunt, my mom's sister. They had an uncle. My grandpa's brother had been in movies back in the 40s. He was in like 12 O'Clock High, had like kind of small parts here and there. And but that was kind of it. So yeah, neither of my parents. I mean, sorry, my dad was in voiceover,
But they didn't have the
none of them. No, not really.
So when you watched that episode, was it kind of like a huge novelty for them where they were like, this is amazing. Like, Bryce is on this show we watch all the time.
Yeah, I don't know, actually. I don't know I don't know how familiar they were with that whole process or whether that was a fascinating thing for them or if that was just kind of, A Day in the Life.
What was their reaction when you got a series? Because that's, I mean, that's such a huge difference in doing a, you know, 1 week worth of work.
It was a big deal. And the interesting thing too is that it comes in stages. You know, right. I mean, like we did the pilot, and then a couple months later, it was like, okay, we're gonna do another 4 or 5 episodes. Right. We came in as a mid-season replacement, so it was like, all right, we get to do some more, and then we'll see where it goes. And then after those aired, then, you know, we got picked up for a second season, and then we moved to a different studio, and that's kind of when it was like real. That was certainly a big deal, but it wasn't like a big, I don't remember it being a big celebration thing.
Right, because like our life is changing now.
Yeah, because I mean, like I said, we kind of like warmed into it.
Right, right. It's probably the way to do it if you're going to do it.
Yeah, well, and I also, you know, they would warn me all the time about you know, not getting a big head and keeping my feet on the ground, because they didn't want to put up with a, you know, a monster. Asshole.
Yeah, which some people did. were they like, you have to work a job in the summer, we're gonna make you be like a normal kid kind of parents? Or
no, well, I never really I mean, 1990, which is when this Challenger movie came out, is when the show ended, and I had just turned, actually right before this issue, had turned 14.
So that's when you'd start doing summer jobs anyway.
Yeah, and so it was after Belvedere that I kind of started high school, and was, you know, I started high school without, you know, without another full-time thing, which I hadn't done since before third grade. And that's when I kind of started to get into more teen stuff, not involved in being on TV. And I got into my high school drama program and stuff like that. So,
which is kind of a great time. That's almost like moving to a new town freshman year.
Yeah.
Like you can kind of start over and it's a good time to do it.
It worked out really well. Yeah. It was, you know, it was a new school, a lot of new friends, a lot of old friends too,
right.
which I think was also good. It was, you know, it was the blend of people who had known me since way back, who knew what I was like and weren't going to make assumptions because I was this kid on TV. And then, you know, a bunch of new people, who I could kind of start fresh with.
Right.
So,
yeah. Was this down in Long Beach?
Yes.
So it was kind of far enough away from LA. Is it fairly down there?
I didn't have a lot of social life up here in Los Angeles at that time.
Which is probably good.
Yeah. I would go to publicity events and things like that, but I wasn't going to like private parties a lot, or, you know, I mean, I think that later on, actually in high school, I went to a couple with friends I had made along the way, but that was it.
So you got a good grounding. It sounds like you got a good sort of solid base in real life to sort of counteract it, which is why you're a good person today.
I used to go back to my public school whenever we weren't working. So whenever we were on hiatus, I would go back to school and get my assignments and see my friends. And I'm told that that wasn't that normal then. That most people, if they were working consistently,
They'd just have a tutor
and they would do that for the entire school year. I guess, yeah, that was a good way to kind of keep me involved with a real life, a regular life.
And were kids cool with it, or did you get a lot of crap?
I mean, yeah, like I said, some of them had been going to school with me since before I was on the show.
Right.
I definitely had, you know, friends from elementary school that I was then at junior high with, and then in high school. There were also people who, you know, thought that I probably thought I was hot shit.
You got to knock you down a few pegs. Yeah. I mean, that's with everything. But the show was enormous. I mean, it was a huge.
It was. Yeah. It's interesting now. I feel like it's not a cult hit, but it wasn't one of the ones that everyone knows, like Growing Pains.
Not
and,
top
you know.
Five. It was like 5 through 10. It was like that second tier, but was consistent the whole time.
And you know, like episodes from seasons 3 on, we were always kind of like on that tipping point in the ratings where we weren't sure whether we were going to make it back or not.
Oh, really?
And I think at one point there was like a big letter writing campaign to save the show.
Which would now, like, the worst rated episode of Belvedere would be number 1.
Oh, yeah.
Now.
Like, well, there's so much competition and so many networks, and, yeah, it's very different now. Yeah, the numbers and I'm sure we probably would have been, you know, if our show had translated directly to today's market, I think we probably would have died out and then been brought back a couple years later, right. thanks to, you know,
like TBS or something.
Yeah, Netflix numbers or Comedy Central. It would be more like TBS. That show wouldn't be on Comedy Central.
But the show was kind of a sleeper show because it was a mid-season replacement. Mm-hmm. On paper, it should not really have. It was based on movies from the 40s.
Yeah.
It was kind of made as a vehicle for Bob Uecker because he had been doing a lot of comparison like to Tonight Show. And people were like, we should get this guy on something. And then I think the showrunners were from Barney Miller. Or,
yeah, that's right.
So they had done a show that was not a, like, the far away from a family sitcom as you could get.
Yeah.
And now they're doing this like blue collar family sitcom. So like nothing about that show on paper should have been a hit. And then it just worked.
Yeah. I mean, I think I guess the only thing about it that was kind of traditional was the idea of like an odd couple kind of comedy, you know, the juxtaposition of Belvedere, and which is the same thing as, you know, Who's the Boss. And
well, that was the Manny subgenre.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
Who's the Boss and Charles in Charge.
Yeah.
And,
which later went to movies with, you know, like what was the one with Vin Diesel?
Oh, The Nanny, I think it's called. Oh, no, the Tooth Fairy. The one where's the
Tooth Fairy? No, there's the Tooth Fairy.
Oh, that's the Rock.
That's the Rock.
Yeah. I can't think of the Vin Diesel one. But when they started that show, it did seem like it was the adversarial relationship was going to be Uecker and Belvedere, but then it kind of shifted to you and Belvedere instead, because it just, that's a better...
Well, or in addition.
Yeah.
But it was easier to pair up Chris and Bob, Belvedere and George, because they were grown-ups, so they could go do some of the same things together. It was easier to kind of put them into situations together where they would have to kind of work together. So they wound up kind of becoming more grudging friends than the adversarial relationship that Belvedere and Wesley had.
One of the things about that show that resonated with me as a kid was the tone shifts were all over the place and it was one of the shows that had a lot of sort of very special episodes.
Yeah.
But it was, when people look back at them now, they seem kind of schizophrenic. But at the time where you're broadcasting and you have whole families watching shows together, it seemed like that was how you get messages out.
Yeah. And I think that might have had something to do with the fact that it was being show run by people who had made Barney Miller, because they wanted to do stuff that was a little edgy, but then they also kind of had to play middle of the road for all these family viewers. So we did wind up doing some kind of controversial stuff.
Yeah, there's the AIDS episode, which is beat, I think, almost every other show to having a character with AIDS. Designing Women did one 2 years after that. The Hogan Family did one of the worst ones I've ever seen. if you've ever seen that one.
I don't think I did.
The producers of that show, I think, may have been the cruelest people on earth, because one of the kids that played Bateman's friend kind of got written out of the show. I don't know what was going on. They brought him back 2 years later. And so Bateman and his other friend are at a hospital and they're doing a documentary for college, and they run into this kid. They haven't seen him. Where you been? He's like, oh, I've been in Europe, whatever. And they're talking to him, and then he walks away, and they ask like one of the orderlies, like, hey, did you see where that guy just went? He goes, oh yeah, he went over there with all the other AIDS patients. And he's like, what happened? He's like, I got AIDS from some chick in Europe. And then they killed him in the span of one episode. Oh, it was like the least respectful.
No.
I was like, what did that actor do?
Wow.
Yeah.
They didn't do arcs back then.
Yeah.
You couldn't
just
do that.
Just gotta resolve it in one episode. They killed the dog in one episode of that show.
Oh,
I was like,
man.
Did the dog want more money there?
Oh.
But, you know, you had things that we just didn't hear about on TV very often at all, because I think the Wesley's Friend episode is 86.
Yeah, yeah, it was very, it was really at the beginning of that. Well, especially for a sitcom.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, I think there were dramas probably dealing with it by that point.
Yeah.
And it was all over the news.
Yeah.
But I think we're the first sitcom to tackle it. And, you know, people will say now, I think I saw an article about it not too long ago that was written recently, and I think it was someone talking about, I think it was broader. It was about, you know, HIV and AIDS in media in general,
in the 80s
and how it was kind of addressed. And they were talking critically about that episode, saying that it was insensitive to make jokes about it. But I always thought, I still think that you know, it was handled in a, I thought it was handled in a very good way, in that the characters who didn't know much about it, or had misconceptions, or had or knew about it and still were kind of right. uneasy because of all the stigmas, you know, they were kind of uncomfortable, and the audience was a little uncomfortable. And then but the kid who played the AIDS patient, I shouldn't say AIDS patient, Wesley's friend.
Yeah.
He was in good humor about it, and it was just kind of a fact of life for him that he was trying to put everyone at ease about. Yeah. And
he used jokes to diffuse the situation, and that's why we like have humor. Like his first line in that episode is, I think George is like, "How you doing, champ?" And he's like, "Well, I got AIDS, but other than that, I'm doing pretty good."
Yeah.
And it's like, but I've known people who've had terminal. That's, they make jokes like that.
Well, and because that's how, you know, when you have that kind of thing, that's how you want people to treat you. Like it's like, it's just a part of your life, but it's not who you are.
Yeah, not a fragile thing that might break. Don't.
Yeah. And I think, you know, there's this idea that it was insensitive because it wasn't speaking enough to the seriousness of the disease, right. and then it was killing all these people. And but I think it was actually very good in terms of how to interact with people who were affected by it.
It humanized it. I think that's what it did, where it wasn't just like, you know, let's have a big speech about the impact in a sort of
Angels in America.
Yeah. Where it's just like, you know, it's obviously we get that, but like we're seeing a kid, you know, who got it from a blood transfusion. It's a kid that goes to school just like any of your kids.
Yeah.
And he's not like the thing that, and I was around the same age as you were in the show, but like the thing that hit me was when kids were like, "I don't want to touch your clothes. You know, I don't want."
Right.
And that's the kind of stuff that kids would do.
Yeah.
And that's the kind of stuff that resonates more than, you know, if we have a bunch of statistics on a family sitcom, you handle it as a family problem, like as an individual problem. And that was interesting. And I remember even at the time, like some affiliates wouldn't air it.
Yeah.
And it got blacked out, and it was a huge deal.
Yeah. It was, it was very controversial.
Do you remember them having to like fight to get that on the air? Or, I mean, I don't know how much of that you would have been privy to anyway.
Yeah, no, I wasn't privy to that much. I remember, it's funny. I remember, meeting affiliates every so often. You know, we would be asked to go. Yeah. We would be asked to go to these events where you would meet people from the local stations all over the country to essentially pimp the show.
Right.
And I remember kind of realizing how the system worked through those parties and realizing, oh yeah, all these networks are, they're like franchises.
Yeah.
They're part of, you know, ABC, but they're also in like control of their own little markets. Own,
yeah.
You know, there's gotta be crazy politics going on through all that. And they were all these kind of like older, uptight.
Yeah. Oh yeah. You know, like I'm a Southern gentleman.
Yeah.
I own Florida TV stations.
Yeah. My family bought these in 1905.
And they made me shut down the plantation, and I decided to run a television station for religious programs. Cause like that one didn't air, in Boston. They actually didn't air the one with the camp counselor
or really?
the Boy Scout leader.
Wow.
So I had to see the one in syndication. And it was just weird what things they were like, we'll show this, but we won't show this.
Yeah. Very odd. Yeah. And yeah, that one was kind of awkward too.
I mean, yeah, that one for you must've been difficult.
It was, I wouldn't say difficult. I mean, you know, if I had been a survivor, I think it would have been very difficult.
But even as a kid actor, like that would,
it was certainly weird. Yeah. I mean, and I also had, you know, shyness and privacy issues with like being shirtless on camera and things like
for
that.
A live audience.
Yeah. So there was, you know, there was that too, but there was an episode where I, imitated Tom Cruise in Risky Business, and I came down the stairs in my underwear and long, you know, long button down shirt. And,
We've all done it.
I wore like multiple pairs of tidy whiteys.
Yeah.
Just because I was like, I wanted to have as much between me and the audience as possible.
This is a one take job that we're doing. I think we got it, goddammit. So were you watching contemporary TV at the time that you were on the show? Were you watching like other ABC shows?
I was. I mean, I watched Who's the Boss, and I watched from this issue. You know, this was in the dawn of TGIF. Yeah. So, I watched Family Matters, and I watched Just the Ten of Us.
Yep, which is my favorite spinoff of all time, let's say.
I would agree with that.
Liked it better than Growing Pains. Growing Pains was a great show until season four, and then all the good writers moved to Just the Ten of Us and never came back. And that show took with it all the stuff I liked about Growing Pains, which is the weird... they would do a lot of weird, like, fourth wall breaking stuff and just some surreal stuff. And also everyone had crushes on all the daughters.
So perfect. all those teen daughters who were like just enough older than me that
perfect friend's older sister to have a
crush
on age.
That was right in that pocket.
Yeah. And did you run into, like you said, you wouldn't really run into them very much, but where did you guys shoot in Warner, or where were you shooting?
We were a 20th Century Fox show.
Okay.
Because I don't like ABC Studios didn't exist. I mean, sorry, ABC. Yeah. ABC Studio. Well, that's weird.
You started at the tail end of stuff like Give Me a Break, and that sort of stuff was coming on.
Yeah. Yeah.
We
first shot at Sunset Gower for the first season, the mid-season replacement. And then we moved to Prospect.
Okay.
Which is called something else now. But that was ABC Prospect then, and that's where General Hospital is. Okay. And
so it wasn't a lot of other sitcoms in there. It was more like...
No, not that many. And then while we were in there, across the hall from us for a while was the Gary Shandling Show.
Oh, wow.
And then the Belvedere creators actually launched... somewhere in there, Sister Kate.
Oh yeah, okay.
Which had Jason Priestley.
Jason Priestley was on it.
Yeah, and so that shot across the hall from us. For
okay, yeah, I loved that show.
Yeah,
it was Stephanie Beecham.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah.
And I remember the set being very similar to ours. I was like, what? But and then now I look back and all the sets were similar.
Yeah,
to ours. Like they all those. Layout. Yeah, they all kind of had that same layout with the stairs in the center and.
Yeah, sometimes it's on the left, sometimes it's on the right. That's the difference. Yeah, yeah. I remember I got some. I may own the world's largest collection of Just the Ten of Us memorabilia, which I'm realizing as I say that out loud, and it's very odd.
I didn't even know there was memorabilia Just the Ten of Us.
A bunch of continuity scripts with like the wardrobe mistresses, like Polaroids.
Uh huh.
And have a parking placard, and then I think like a crew jacket and some scripts or something.
Uh huh.
But the Polaroids were amazing because, and I don't mean this in a creepy way after we just talked about crushes on the women of the show, but most of them are like taken from right behind the set when the person's going to enter the stage.
Yeah.
So you can see, as someone who wasn't there, you can see how the set is set up. You know, there's nothing, or at the top of the stairs, there's nothing.
Yeah.
And it was kind of fascinating. And I'm like, oh,
the back of the
shows are probably like that. Yeah, there's just nothing there. Which was kind of, I'm glad I saw it as an adult and not as a child.
Cause
like, no, it's a lie.
It's all a lie.
But there was a show on, and I think it was actually on after Belvedere for one season called I Married Dora.
Oh yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah.
That had the craziest season ending episode I've ever seen.
Yes. That was on our lot actually. If I remember correctly, but not in our
little building
studio there. Our building. Yeah.
Because that show with Elizabeth Payne, who I loved, and was amazing in Jacob's Ladder.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, that episode, that speaking of the fourth wall breaking, have you seen that last episode where it was like a will they, won't they, because he married his housekeeper to keep her in the country. So last episode, he's flying somewhere. She decides she loves him. She goes to the airport to tell him that. And he's standing with his bags. And she's like, what are you doing? He goes, it's canceled. And she goes, your flight got canceled. He goes, no, our show is canceled. And they pull the camera back and show the audience and the crew.
That's
and
right.
then just fades to black. And I remember being like 8 years old and being like, what the hell just happened? Like, it just totally blew my mind. Because before Gary Shandling.
The illusion.
why, what have they done? Yeah, it was like the Matrix all of a sudden. And it was such a weird thing. And for whatever reason, at that time, ABC was doing a lot of strange stuff. And I don't know if it was because they were just like, I don't know. And a lot of their longstanding shows had ended. So they were just kind of seeing whatever weird thing, like The Charmings.
Yes. Yeah, The Charmings. Yeah, I knew Brandon Call from that show.
Oh, yeah.
Wow, yeah.
There was a lot of bizarre...
Yeah, the Charmings was weird.
That was super weird. And they retooled... It made two seasons, which is extra strange.
Yeah.
And they retooled it the second season. Yeah. And I was like, how did this show get made for two seasons? It's like an SNL sketch.
Yeah.
It's like a parody of a sitcom.
It is. Yeah, it's like if you tried to do the Coneheads as a full half hour every week.
Yeah, but it was on for some strange reason.
Yeah.
Were there ever a show that you were like psyched that was filming near you? You're like, oh, I want to go watch them shoot this show or anything? Or that you try to sneak onto the sets of?
No. It's funny. I just talked about this on the Mortified podcast, but I was a big fan of Family Ties and Michael J. Fox. So that was a big deal when I got to go to that.
Because they were down at Paramount, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
did you just go as a like an audience member? You got to go?
Yeah, basically. I went and sat in the crowd, and which was interesting in itself, having been on the other side of it.
Right.
And knowing how the whole process worked, but it was very interesting to actually go through that and like have to wait with everyone and realize what a long drawn out process that is for the
yeah.
It's like, wow, how does anyone have the energy to laugh after this?
Did anyone recognize you when you were in the crowd?
I feel like they did. I'm sure I talked to a couple people.
That show was, I remember being completely traumatized when that show ended, and they had another sort of fourth one because they had that episode that was 10 minutes longer, and they went out and did the curtain call,
right?
And I think it was 9 or 10, and that show had literally been on for like 80% of my life.
Yeah,
so it was like, it's over, what am I gonna do now? It's just such a huge traumatic thing.
And when I did American Dreamer, which we which we talked about, we were on that same stage. And that show had a big fourth wall break as part of the format.
Right.
It was similar to Gary Shandling in that way, where it was all kind of within the fourth wall, and then Robert Urich would kind of step out into like a limbo,
right,
where the lights would dim,
like Our Town or something.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah. Where he'd like step into black and talk to camera. And that was, it was, you know, as if he was like talking to a journal or something.
Right,
but,
right.
Yeah.
I loved Robert Urich because, again, another ABC show, Spencer for Hire, which they shot in Boston. And that was, Boston is a town that everything you know about it is true. Everything bad thing. But there's also another weird thing where it's a huge town where people enjoy lying as like a bragging thing.
Oh, yeah.
And the lies always shift. And one of the big lies currently is always like, I fought Marky Mark. That seems to be a big lie. But like,
of course.
But I kicked his ass and like that. Someone's brother will have that. But when Spencer for Hire was on, it was always like, my father was on that. Yeah, he played a killer. Like that, because you couldn't confirm it, you know.
Right.
Most kids couldn't watch it, but we could go and watch them film it all the time. So it was amazing to see Robert Urich like killing dudes in the street for 7 hours. And I loved that show, and that was for a time was on the same night as Belvedere, and then they paired it with Dolly Parton's variety show. So on Sunday nights it was Spencer for Hire for an hour, and then Dolly for an hour on ABC.
Wow.
It was the weirdest 2-hour block.
That's an odd dichotomy.
Yeah. Her show was great.
I bet.
It was, she'd come out up top. It was like Carol Burnett, and she'd come out up top and take questions from the audience. And then she would have a co-host. And then there was a running sitcom within the show that was a drama about her working at a truck stop. And then she would do songs, and it was only one season. And it was the last variety show I can think of that was actually on the air. It was crazy.
How interesting. They did a show within the show that was like a regular...
And it had continuity, and it was really weird. And Miss Picky co-hosted an episode.
Interesting idea.
It was... But it seemed far removed. Like, I imagine that the other ABC shows weren't like, hey, here's all the shows on our network. You should know what else is on. Like that.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
It was weird for her to return to TV then, too, because she had done all those movies.
Right.
That was probably 87, I think. But yeah, I was an ABC guy, so, and I knew it was on.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Were you going to any like the award shows or those sorts of things? Like, did they,
no, I know we were up for, we were up for, a couple Emmys, but they were technical Emmys. Right. Like, I think our lighting designer won an Emmy
and
once or twice.
Ceremonies held earlier.
Yes, yeah, exactly. Yeah. So I never went to anything that big. At that time, I don't know if they're still doing it, but they had a thing called the Youth in Film Awards.
Oh yeah, okay.
Which was like kind of the kid award thing, right. before Nickelodeon started
Kids
doing
Choice.
It. Yeah, before Kids Choice came along, this was not televised. And I was nominated for a few of those, and I won one eventually, but for a play randomly, right. Not for
like
not
in
for
high
the
school
show.
Later.
No, well, no, it would have been it was a play I did where I was in repertory with Alexander Polinsky.
Oh, wow.
From Charles in Charge.
Yep.
He was
does
he
a lot
was,
of voiceover now. Speaking of cartoons, yeah.
And so he and I played the same role at different times. And Paul Kreppel directed it.
From It's a Living.
Yeah, exactly. So that show got reviewed, and I got an award for that. But
did you find theater stuff super easy after doing the sitcom? Because it was basically like training ground for doing kind of live theater.
Yeah, in a sense. Well, and you had more time to get it right.
Right.
You know, which in that way it was in some ways easier. But, then they also expected you. I was getting to the point where they expected you to dig a little deeper your characters.
Yeah.
So that was a bit of work. But I learned a lot of techniques that I'd never learned doing a sitcom in terms of building a character and stuff that I never get a chance to use now since I'm not doing that much on stage. But.
Right. But you started doing more comedy. Like, did you always have an affinity for comedy stuff?
Yeah, definitely. And, now I do some sketch comedy and my writing partner and I write a lot of comedic, even our hour long scripts and stuff. I have a lot of comedy in them. So I've definitely put those chops to use.
Were you watching a lot of sketch comedy stuff when you were growing up, or were you?
In my teen years, I did. Yeah. Yeah, growing up, I watched a lot of Monty Python.
Yes, as evident by your Karate Kid Monty Python mashup shirt, which
is
fantastic.
Yes, Ministry of Silly Walks.
Ministry of Silly Crane Kicks.
Yeah, that was it was one of my dad's favorites. So I would watch a lot of Monty Python as a kid, and then later it was Kids in the Hall and Mr. Show.
The classics. Yeah, but I saw a lot of that. Sort of influence in I Hate My 30s, the show you did on VH1, almost reminded me of like an office set Strangers with Candy. Not as weird,
right?
But it had that sort of surreal, sketchy vibe to a sitcom. Basically.
Yeah, we like to, we like to think that we were just a little bit ahead of our time because right after us, just like a year or two after that show, Community came out,
right,
and was doing a lot of the same stuff we were doing. But yeah, that show was born out of our sketch variety show that was pretty popular around then, or I should say was at its height around that time. And the executives at VH1 had come to see that and wanted to develop something with us. So that was definitely born out of that kind of humor. And nowadays it seems like everything we do is much more meta.
But that's the tone. I mean, that's sort of the tone of that. It was just slightly shifted a little bit. And it seemed like a little bit, like as you said, it was a little too early for people to kind of be on board with that.
Yeah.
But I enjoyed it.
It's very self-aware.
One of the things I remember seeing you on Pop Up One too is you would pop up on game shows sometimes as a kid. Mm-hmm. And I always wondered what that was like because you're now being yourself. Like, I remember seeing you on Animal Crackups, Alan Thicke's show.
Yes.
Where Alan Thicke, may rest in peace, sang the theme song, which was the best.
Gosh, I'd forgotten all about that. That's
and
right.
You were playing for like an animal charity and you'd win like hedgehogs, or you'd show up on like Grand Pictionary or Win Lizard Draw.
Yeah, I was on Teen Win Lizard Draw. I shot that in Florida.
Oh, really?
Actually, yeah.
Mark Price hosted the
Teen Win Lizard Draw? They did that out of the
Universal Orlando.
Yeah, I don't think it was It was
there was Nickelodeon Studios and then Universal.
I know there. I think it was Disney.
Oh, okay.
Actually, that was like it was like the same place they were doing the Mouseketeers at that time. The Mickey Mouse Club.
The thing that changed that all the biggest stars.
Yeah,
in the world
changed
came out
pop
of.
Music as we know it.
Yeah.
I shot that one in Florida. I was also on. I did an episode of Hollywood Squares.
Oh, nice.
With Christopher Hewitt, we shared a square.
Oh,
that was it. Was a little
that's
cramped.
Tight. Yeah,
it was a little cramped.
Which square were you?
We were, I want to say, bottom right.
I think
we were bottom right.
I would have, not nightmares, but I would watch that show and get anxiety about the people in the top squares because it seems like it was really high up.
Yeah, well, it's...
no back.
No, it does have a back. That's what you don't see. Okay. Yeah, no, the catwalks are actually pretty wide. No one was going to fall out of there. But yeah, it does seem like...
It seems like it's dangerously high.
It does. Like, you think that, you know, someone's going to lean back in their chair and tumble over.
Well, there was a, and it's not the best sketch, but Fridays, and it was a sketch actually written by Larry David,
right?
Where they did a Hollywood Squares parody, but it was a Rubik's cube, and then they would turn the cube, and all these people were falling out, and like being crushed by the thing, which is such a dumb joke. And it doesn't.
How did they do that?
They had like a model, and it'd be like, okay, well, let's turn the cube, and then they'd show you, and you'd see all these little people fall out and scream, and then like Larry David was playing the host, and he'd be like, well, we lost this Jamie Farr, and sadly this person was crushed on the thing, and it was such a dumb sketch, but it tapped into my fears.
Sounds like a Joel Hodgson bit.
It does seem like a Joel Hodgson. It's very TV Wheel.
Yeah.
And then you're in maybe my favorite episode of Burn Notice.
Really?
The siege episode in the bank.
Yeah.
Where he's like got a, and it has what's his name? The guy who plays Crowley on Supernatural. The British guy.
Yeah, Mark Shepard.
Mark Shepard. Yeah, yeah, he's like the main bad guy. That's such a great episode.
Oh, I'm glad you like it. That's so funny. That's a great segue because the guy who wrote that episode, my friend Mike Horowitz, wrote one of the shows I'm doing at Sketchfest.
Oh, wow.
It's the one we just took to Edinburgh.
Yeah, yeah.
Carnal Desire. And he had written it when he was just becoming a screenwriter. He was working at a cable network, and so he wrote some softcore porn scripts for the late night programming. Excellent. That they were doing there. And so we read those on stage.
Yeah.
And they're very, very funny.
I've written some of those as well for Skinamax movies. Yeah. I've done polishes for people.
Yeah.
What was the one that this guy Jim Wynorski does a bunch, and Friddle and Ray directed a bunch. I wrote for him a thing called The Treasures of Black Cinema. Which was this?
What?
These are the two. I got them at the same time. And The Treasures of Black Cinema was he had bought the rights to all these race movies, which were all black cast movies from the 30s and 40s.
Oh,
so
wow.
It was like an all black cowboy movie called The Bronze Buckaroo. And there was hundreds of them. And they would play like in inner cities and just like The Terror of Tiny Town, but instead of some little people, it was
wow.
And so he bought all these rights and he wanted to put them in a DVD set with like Turner Classic Movies style intros.
Yeah.
So we hired Richard Roundtree to host these things, and I wrote all the Richard Roundtree segments.
Okay.
And it was super weird because I researched it and I did it from Boston and I emailed the scripts and then 6 months later I get a DVD back with Richard Roundtree saying all the stuff I emailed, and it was just such a weird thing, and I got credited, and there's one movie that's about voodoo, and I wrote, I don't even know why I wrote it this way, but it's Richard Roundtree staring at the camera and he's like, voodoo. And then there's like a really long pause. And then I was like, I guess I made that happen somehow. It was very strange.
You didn't realize you had written a bunch of ellipses.
Yeah. In there. Just put the four extra pages got in there on the photocopy machine. And he was like, I see here.
I'm going to wait this out.
Yeah, absolutely. But you were saying you were a huge movie guy. Really TV at this time. Were you like video store junkie or?
No, it's funny. Well, at the time I was a TV guy. I would kind of watch whatever was on, especially like Nick at Night. I've always been a night owl.
Same.
So I was, you know, usually up late and watching, especially Nick at Night, and watching all those old shows.
Which is a great education on.
Yeah.
Stuff. And they're so ahead of their time.
Yeah. And then later when I went off to college and then, you know, had my own place and had cable and all that stuff, I started to kind of catch up on a lot of the movies I had missed. I became kind of a cinephile at that point and, you know, educated myself more on cinema and a lot of the, you know, I'd missed out on a lot of like horror movies and sex comedies and stuff from my, what would have been my era. And so I kind of caught up on all that stuff after
Revenge
the fact.
Revenge of the Nerds and Real Genius, which might be my favorite comedy of all time.
Not to mention then all the, you know, all the ones going back farther like Kubrick and Hitchcock and all that
stuff. The quality cinema.
Yeah.
Yeah. But the contemporary stuff that like as a kid you would have probably seen in the theater if you weren't working.
Right.
You had to catch up on that stuff.
Yeah. I mean, I think, again, I was, I was a little bit of a loner. just because I tend to be a loner anyway, kind of a, you know,
the best of us are.
Yeah. Introverted guy. Yeah.
Guys, he pulled up on a motorcycle here and he had a switchblade comb. I got kicked out of a state fair for having a switchblade comb once.
Really?
Because they sold them there. I must have been like 11.
That's bizarre.
Yeah, I was probably 11 and we went there on a school trip and I was like, you know, have a switchblade comb, and the security guard ran over and was like, "You can't bring that shit in here," and like kicked us all out. And
I just wanted it, that booth over there.
Yeah,
I was
like, I paid for this from the honey guy. Yeah, but that's the tough lesson of switchblade combs.
Wow. Yeah, I had one of those too. Yeah,
they're great. Don't try to fly on a plane with them.
No, I wouldn't use it now. It seems a little juvenile.
The problem is too that they're not great combs. They don't tend to hold their shape, so they've got to really struggle.
Yeah,
probably damage yourself.
Yeah, and they're pretty, and you know, they were narrow.
Oh yeah.
So
yeah, it's not. It's good for like, I guess it'd be good for combing a goatee.
Sure.
So maybe that's the kind of person.
Maybe that's what it was for. Yeah, it was for the beatniks. Yeah.
We got all these goatee combs, and these kids aren't beatniks anymore. What do? Put them in a weapon of some sort.
Yeah. Bring the goatee back.
Yeah.
Make the goatee popular again.
Were you ever, because I know a lot of the other people that I know who were actors as kids at that time would get a lot of like companies trying to get them to like wear their stuff or like endorse their things.
I did get some free stuff from some people. I got a lot of Nike stuff at one point. Actually, I think that was it.
Yeah, that's still pretty good.
No, it was great.
And they weren't trying to set up like photo, like PR photo ops and stuff. Because I don't remember really pop up in like the teen mags and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, not that much. I you know, every once in a while they would do a little blurb about me or put a picture in like Tiger Beat or something.
Just gotta be strange.
Wow.
Yeah.
Magazine.
Bop.
Yeah, very strange. But yeah, I wasn't as much of a heartthrob type as some of the other guys.
Rob seemed to be getting a lot of that stuff.
Yeah, Rob got a lot of that stuff.
That must have been odd watching that kind of thing happen.
It was fun. I liked seeing him do stuff like he did an after school special, which was a musical, something like that. It was about gangs. It was like a gang. It was like a weird. It was like they were trying to update West Side Story. But it just came off kind of like not like gang culture of the time at all.
Yeah, it's like kids are in 50s gangs. It was like the Wanderers, but set contemporary. Yeah. Well, you were in, was it a teen pregnancy one that you were in? You did one.
Yes. I was in. No, it's not teen pregnancy, but it was called Two Teens and a Baby.
Okay.
Which is kind of misleading, but it was supposed to be about two teenage brothers who were having to deal with the fact that their mom was pregnant again, having a new baby. Okay. So it was like two grown kids who were kind of used to having the place to themselves, now having to deal with helping kid, kind of, yeah.
So you didn't get stuck with a real heavy one like Gangs That Dance.
No, I didn't. No, that was Maureen Flanagan was in that one.
Oh, really? Yeah.
Yeah.
Of Out of This World fame.
Yeah.
Yep. Who you did that Funny or Die, that Andrew Kirk Cameron Funny or Die video.
Yeah.
Were you guys all aware of a guy like that at the time? Or is that, how much of that kind of video is fictitious and how much is the people there were like, oh God, Kirk Cameron.
Oh man. I didn't know about any of that stuff at the time. And you know, I met him once or twice. We would be at the same things. I think he and Tracy, who played my sister, were hanging out for a little while, I want to say.
And Candace was on Full House. That was on.
Yeah. I knew Candace a little bit, and I knew Jodie Sweetin. Because she was also kind of from the Long Beach area. We would sometimes wind up carpooling to things if they're, you know, they were doing like a van. I didn't know Kirk well. I know my sister got to dance with him once.
Oh, wow.
I think at one of our rap parties. which that was a big deal for her.
I bet.
She's a few years younger than I am.
Yeah.
That was nice of him to do.
And then you had maybe the hardest working kid actor on at the time, who played Miles, who was concurrently on Punky Brewster at the
Casey,
same time.
Yeah, Casey Ellison seemed to be in everything.
I thought there were rules around how much a kid can act in things. And he's like a pretty major supporting character in two shows concurrently.
Yeah.
I don't know how that was allowed.
As long as they got it within his 9-hour workday, I think He could be on whatever he wanted.
As a kid, I theorized he had the headgear on Belvedere so that he could pretend it was a different kid.
Yeah.
No, I wasn't on that other show.
Yeah, it's just to differentiate from his character on Punky Brewster.
Not Alan. That's fair.
That is a different guy.
Totally different. Was there a movie that you... Because we were talking a little bit earlier, recently rewatched Twin Peaks, or watched Twin Peaks actually
I hadn't watched it the first time it was on.
And, you know, you enjoyed it, but there's some of it's kind of, you kind of had to see it at the time.
Yeah, I feel like some of it doesn't really hold up now.
Yeah.
And I know they had weird, like, issues with the writing and...
Oh, the second season is...
Not knowing if they were going to be coming back or whatever. There was all kind of, like,
Windham Earle comes
changeovers.
Was there a movie that, like, you had caught up on later that everybody loved that you were like, I can't, it just doesn't do anything for me?
I recently watched for the first time The Outsiders.
Okay.
And I have to say, I think that movie is terrible.
I hated the book too.
People seem to have such a fondness for that film, and having seen it now, as I mean, you know, I was approaching 40 at the time, and maybe I was already 40. Did I just watch it last year? Anyway.
It was what you watched for your 40th birthday.
No.
I want to see The Outsiders.
It wasn't that. No, it wasn't that.
In a theater.
But having, you know, watching it at the age I am now, and this many years after it originally came out, not only do I think it doesn't hold up, I don't know why people thought it was so great to begin with.
I'm the same. I remember that book that they made us read that book in high school, and I was like, this book's kind of stupid.
Yeah.
And I was like, soda pop? Like, what do they have these names? Like, it just, you know, I'm maybe 11 or something, and kids are like, this is great. It's like real tough kids and stuff. And I saw the movie, and I was like, I know, I can't.
Well, and
Heather Langenkamp's in that, speaking of Justice Tennis.
Yes.
This is her first movie. That's why she moved out here.
That's right.
Because they shot it in Kansas or Nebraska, wherever she's from.
Yeah. And you know, I mean, I thought she was great in Nightmare on Elm Street.
Yeah. Yeah.
And multiple Nightmare on Elm Street.
Yep. But... 1, 3, and 7.
Yeah.
Are you a horror fan now? But you
need
your dark, so you kind of have to.
I am. Well, especially like B horror. Like, yeah. I used to watch, like I said, kind of when I had my own, once I got my own cable, I still watch a lot of Turner Classic Movies, but back then also AMC was doing a lot more old movie stuff, and they would show a lot of B, like, sci-fi and horror movies, and I love all that stuff, the old horror movies.
Oh, yeah. And Up All Night and Joe Bob Briggs.
Yeah, exactly. And Dinner and a Movie.
Yeah.
And stuff like that.
Annabelle Gurwitch hosted that with, what's his name that does the Mental Illness Happy Hour? Paul Gilmartin, the comedian. Yeah.
So, I don't know if I'd say I'm a horror fan, or I wouldn't say I'm a horror aficionado.
Right.
I'm not really, you know, I'm not so much into like the gore pictures, but I like spooky stuff, and especially classic, and sometimes, you know, sometimes I'll enjoy horror movies for camp value, and then some, you know, there are some that I have a friend who I, you know, she and I kind of only go to horror movies together. That's kind of our thing. And so that'll be, you know, found footage ones.
Paranormal activity.
Yeah, the paranormal activities of the world.
Which I have still not seen.
Really?
Yeah, I heard the first one was very good, and then I haven't.
The first one was, I thought the first one was very good. I follow Katie on Twitter because I thought she was great in it.
I kind of, the weirdest thing is, the joke I make in my act is that I don't care about anything made after the year 2000, including people.
Uh-huh.
But I kind of checked out a little bit after that.
Yeah.
I was like, I kind of seen everything I wanted to see.
Yeah.
But horror movies kind of shifted too. And I was also catching up on stuff I missed just from volume or access as a kid. And so I went to the movies every Wednesday from 1982 till 2002.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was just like, I'm not going anymore. And so I just got like tired of people, and I could watch it on DVD in 6 months or, you know, whatever it was.
Yeah.
So I missed out on a lot of the newer
stuff. And that's the thing. Like, movies kind of became the, like, I got to see it in the theater because it's going to be this kind of experience, or you just wait. And, you know, I feel like a lot of horror movies are kind of like, I'll see it eventually.
Yeah. Although I saw Krampus recently from last year.
Me too.
It was great. I really enjoyed
it. Yeah. It's really, I wasn't sure what to think about the ending.
Yeah.
I was a little like, wow, this is weird.
That was odd. Yeah. I was like, they're all dead?
I liked it. No spoilers.
They're all dead in the end of Krampus, everybody. Merry Christmas. it's my war on Christmas. I just shot the first show. But again, all comedy people doing a horror movie, which is
Which is great. Yeah. I mean, and that has a, you know, that has a long proud tradition. What's the one about the TV signal?
Oh, Terrorvision?
Terrorvision.
With Garrett Graham. Yeah, I love that movie.
Yeah.
That movie is unbelievably bizarre.
Yeah.
Charles Band produced that movie in Italy, in the old De Laurentiis studios.
Right.
But that movie's nuts. Yeah. That's a fantastic movie. Is there anything you watch now or like any show that you revisit?
Old shows?
Yeah. Like a comfort show? Because as a Nick at Night fan, are you like a MeTV antenna?
It's funny. I don't really. I got on movies and that kind of became my thing. I mean, I watch there are some new shows that I watch, but even that I don't have that many series.
Right.
I watch a lot of movies, and a lot of times I'll just watch what's on, or I'll look for things on like I said, Turner Classic Movies.
Yeah.
Always great to just kind of see what's happening over there.
Yeah, it's fun to have a as much as we can find anything we want at any time, it's fun to have something curated.
Yeah.
And they say, like, this is good, or with an intro or in context or something. That's kind of what we're
saying. There's always something coming up, like the next day or later that night that's like, oh, I love that one. I gotta see that.
I gotta stay up and watch that.
Yeah.
Even though I could tape it on my DVR.
Right.
Well, thank you so much for doing this for me.
Yeah, thank you.
You're welcome.
I was right. He's great. Bryce, super good guy. And as I said, very funny. Does a lot of sketch stuff now. Doing a lot of the festivals. Was at Edinburgh and SF Sketch Fest. I will put up links on TVGuidanceCounselor.com to all his sketch stuff so you can follow his group. Not in a stalker way. Not physically follow them, but just see where they're playing. They're doing a lot of comedy festivals. And if one is remotely close to where you live, you should go and see them because you will enjoy it very much. You could also see me do stand-up if you want. If you go to ICanRead.com. TVGuidanceCounselor.com has all the links. Thanks for everything Bryce is working on, all my guests that have been on the show, what I'm working on, all that kind of stuff. You can also email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com, ken@icanread.com. I have more than one email address. I don't know why. I'm just one person. Or you can go to our Facebook page, just search TV Guidance Counselor. As of now, we are the only one on there, unless some patent troll tries to steal the show from me, which would be a rude awakening to them because it is not very lucrative. But I'm not here to complain. I love doing it. I love having you guys on the show as listeners. You're not on the show, but you're listening to the show, and you're sort of under the show. I have no idea what that means. It's very philosophical. Think about it. Won't you? Thank you. Wow, I sound completely bonkers. This is what happens when you record conversations, intro, outros, just yourself in a room. It's a little bit odd, but you end up just babbling and talking nonsense. And I just want you to know I'm aware of it. I'm not insane. I know this sounds crazy, and I will do my best to not do this in the future. But what I will do in the future is have a brand new episode each and every Wednesday, just like today. So make sure that you subscribe to the show on iTunes or Google Play or however you heard the show here. It's a huge help if you want to rate and review the show, but obviously you don't have to. But we will see you next time if you enjoyed the show and you do want to come back. I won't force it on you, but hopefully we'll see you again for a brand new episode of TV Guidance Counselor.
I wore like multiple pairs of tidy whities.
Yeah.
Just because I was like, I wanted to have as much between me and the audience as possible.